Hey guys, it's Flaming Sheep here with more Gatecrash spoilers for January 5th, 2013. So it's a new year. Happy New Year, everyone. 2013 is going to bring us some very exciting things, some of which are coming from Gatecrash. So let's check out what we have now. This is a weekly roundup. I didn't get a chance to do one every day, but we'll talk about all the cards that have been spoiled this week. Starting with the new Kiruns. We have Dimer Kirun and Gruul Kirun. Again, they cost 3 mana. They're artifacts to tap for one of the two guild colors, and then for paying for 2 converted mana costs, one of each guild color, you get to activate them, turn them into creatures, and this is what they do. The Dimer Kirun becomes a 2/2 blue and black horror artifact creature that is unblockable until end of turn, and the Gruul one turns into a 3/2 red and green beast creature with trample. Pretty standard stuff, if you ask me. So they're very appropriate abilities for the two colors, and they make sense in the context of their guilds. So, whatever, pretty normal stuff. Then we go on to Angelic Skirmisher. It's 6 mana, 4 white-white, for a 4/4 flying angel. And at the beginning of each combat, you can choose First Strike, Vigilance, or Lifelink, and all creatures you control get that ability till end of turn. Seems pretty good. I would say pretty bomby and limited. You definitely want to snap that up. I don't think it has much constructed potential. And the picture looks, I don't know. It just doesn't feel magic to me. It's got like a weird look to it. It's okay. I mean, it's a very good picture, but it just doesn't feel like it's magic to me. I don't know why. Whatever. Angelic Skirmisher. Then we have Hands of Binding. So it's 1 blue for a sorcery. Sorry about that. 1 blue for a sorcery. Tap targets creature an opponent controls. That creature doesn't tap during his controls next untap step, which has Cypher. As you remember, Cypher is the new Dimer ability, and basically you exile the card, attach it to a creature. When the creature deals combat damage, you copy the spell. So it's pretty sweet. It becomes you can really tap down a guy forever and ever and ever. It's sort of inaction junction-esque, except more repeatable, but without the card draw. So very interesting card. I like it. And then we have Cryptghast, which is insane. So it's 3 black for a 2/2 with Extort, and if you remember Extort, whenever you play a spell, you can pay black or white, and then you drain an opponent. Each opponent you drain for 1 life. And whenever you tap a swamp, add black to your mana pool, so it basically becomes like a Cabal Coffers for all your swamps, which is really awesome. I wonder if they'll be able to break this some way. It seems like a very Johnny card, a very combo-y card. And at the very least, I mean, whenever you cast something, you can cast things for cheaper. You can get 8 mana on turn 4. Turn 5, you can get 10 mana. Like, if you get this out on turn 4, on turn 5, you can potentially get up to 10 mana. You can cast Gristlebrand. You can cast, tons of crazy things for 7 mana. 8 to 10 mana, which is just very exciting. Oh, Army of the Damned, you can cast for 8 mana, so very exciting. Skullcrack, 1 red, instant. Players can't gain life this turn. Damage can't be prevented. Deal 3 damage to target player. Very straightforward. Very aggro, mono-ready type card. Might see some play in aggro, mono-red. Pretty straightforward. Not that great and limited. Because it doesn't kill guys. If it dealt damage to creatures too, this card would be insane. I mean, it would be strictly better than Flame Spear? Shoot, I can't even remember what it's called. But anyways, the Incinerate replacement in M13. Scarred Goliath is an 8 mana creature, 6 green green for 9/9 Trampler. So that guy's huge, right? But the cool thing about him is that he has Blood Rush. So if you pay 5 green green and discard this card, you basically channel it and target attacking creature gets +9/+9 and trample. So this will win games. Like straight up, if you get 7 mana, this guy will bomb him out, because it's basically haste and trample on a dude, right? 7 mana is a lot, though, but it looks like Gruul is sort of the ramp deck now. They've become the sort of ramp guild. So I'm pretty excited to see what happens there. Orzhov has a couple cool new cards. There's Alm Beast, which is 2 white black for a 6/6 creature, and creatures blocking are blocked by Alm Beast have lifelink. So that's a pretty fine price to pay, in my opinion, to get a 6/6 for 4. I think that's very playable and limited. Maybe even in Constructed, because there aren't that many creatures. Like, people don't block in Constructed. That's crazy. It's crazy talk. And who cares if they have lifelink, right? Whatever. You will beat them down sooner or later. So this is, again, kind of grindy. Shows the grindy nature of Orzhov. Even though this guy's a 6-6, you may not be able to take down your opponent that fast because of the lifelink it gives, but pretty sweet. And then High Priest of Penance. People have really been talking about this card. It's white-black for a 1-1 human cleric. Whenever this card's dealt damage, you may destroy target non-land permanent. So people are talking about, well, you know, giving it indestructibility or regen with artifacts and equipment. Fine. Sure, that makes sense. People are saying that it's just Death Touch, a fancy Death Touch. But it can kill artifacts, it can kill enchantments, it can kill planeswalkers. So people are speculating that it might be worth a lot. I don't know. 2 for 1/1? We'll see. Maybe some deck in Constructed will like to play it. Until then, it seems like an interesting card, to say the least. Then we've got some Demir cards. We've got Consuming Aberration, 3 blue-black for a creature horror that has power and toughness equal to number of cards in opponent's graveyards. So again, very good in multiplayer. That guy looks huge if you look at the picture. Holy cow. And then whenever you cast a spell, each opponent reveals cards off the top of his library until he or she reveals a land card, then puts those cards into his or her graveyard. So it's a mill card. Sure. So Demir is back on the mill plan, which I'm very excited about, because back in the day when I was playing Ravnica City of Guilds, holy cow, I like force drafted Demir all the time and milled people out, and it was so much fun and so awesome. Yeah. Night Vale Spectre. So this is hybrid, 3 mana for 2/3 flyer Spectre, and when it deals damage to a player, that player exiles a top card of his or her library, and you can play cards exiled by it. So you can play lands. If you're in the same colors, you can play their spells. Seems pretty neat. I mean, it's not Hypnotic Spectre, which is 3 for 2/2 with the random discard. But could be okay. Seems all right. And then we have Foundry Champion. So 4 red-white for a 4/4. When it enters the battlefield, deals damage to target creature or player equal to the number of creatures you control. So very Borosy. You know, you want to have a lot of creatures out. You want to be attacking a lot. Plus, it has fire breathing on it and the like shield, white shield ability. So red, one red gives +1/+0. White gives +0/+1. 6 for 4/4 rare. So it's kind of a Flame Tongue Cavalry type card. So I think it'll be very good and limited. And you know, it seems pretty solid in limited. Yeah. Then we have Sky Knight Legionnaire. So it's a reprint from Ravnica Save Guilds. It's 3 mana for 2/2 flyer with haste. A really good card. A really terrible picture. I'm sorry. Some people really like it. I think it's just weird. Like, do you remember the old picture? That was a sweet card, right? Like, that was a staple of Boros. You remembered 3 for 2/2 flying haste. Awesome card. Sweet Drake type thing in the background. I mean, sweet Drake type thing that the Sky Knight's riding, and it just looks awesome. You see the little Boros legions down there. Like, so cool, that artwork. And this one, like, what is that? Is that like a crotch shot? Like, should we be doing that? I think that's probably a bit more appropriate, since, you know, Magic should be a family game. What is that? I guess clearly the Sky Knight Legionnaire went out on the town, got drunk, climbed out of a limo, and oops, crotch shot, right? Like, it just, I don't know. I don't know what I feel about that. Not good, I think. Not good. The next card is Clan Defiance. It's a Gruul card, and it is sweet. It's X red green for a sorcery, and you can choose one or more, and there are 3 modes here, so you can use up to 3 modes. So it deals X damage to target creature flying, X damage to target creature without flying, and or X damage to target player. So you can kill 3 guys with 1 card. That's sick. I mean, you're almost absolutely going to do 2 for 1 in limited. This is such a good card. Such a good card. Fireballs are always awesome in limited, and this one is a fireball plus a removal spell all in one. I cannot gush enough about that card. It's really sweet for limited. Then we have a bunch of Simic cards. We got Biovisionary, so it's 1 green-blue. For a 2/3, and then at the beginning of the end step, if you control 4 more creatures named Biovisionary, you win the game. Pretty sweet. So I guess you want to get that card. You can... what's that card with Kicker? I should have put it up here. I totally forgot about it at the time. Anyways, like the copy, you know, make make a token copy of it, and it has kicker, and you can make like five of them or whatever. That card could win you the game. It's kind of neat to see alternate win conditions. It's sort of like a laboratory maniac. I mean, not very viable. Obviously useless in limited, and probably not going to be a big deal in constructed. But it's always neat to see alternate win condition cards being printed. I love them. Elusive Crassus is, again, 3 mana, so 1 green blue for a... It's a fish mutant, so that in itself makes it sweet. It's a 0/4 fish mutant. It's unblockable. What? Because it has Evolve. So the Simic ability, where if you play a creature with more power or toughness than this guy, it gets a +1/+1 counter on it. So you play this on turn 3. On turn 4, you play a creature. It's now a 1/5 unblockable. Not very exciting. You play a few more creatures, and hopefully it becomes 2/3. Power unblockable, and then it becomes a thing. But it's also a wall too, so like if you're playing a bit of a controlling strategy, you know, you play it early and limited as a wall, block the beats, and then after you've played a few creatures, made them bigger, then it becomes an attacker that can't be blocked with huge butt that you can't kill usually. So actually, yeah, I like it. I think it's pretty good. And it's a fish mutant. Let's not forget that. That's awesome. And then we have Mystic Genesis. So it's 2 green, blue, blue, instant. Counter target spell, put an XX green ooze token onto the battlefield where X is the spell's converted mana cost. So it's kind of like that, was it Hatchling Drake or whatever? I can't remember. It was like 6 mana, comes in, it's like a flyer that comes into play with +1/+1 counters on it equal to the converted mana cost of a spell you countered. So it's 1 less, so it's 5 mana now. But 5 mana for a counter spell isn't amazing, even if you get a dude as well. Because the dude's probably going to be, what, like 2-2, 3-3, 4-4 maybe at most. But, like, that sucks when it's that. I mean, if you counter, like, a 7th mana cost spell, that's awesome, right? But sometimes 5 mana is just too much for a counter spell, in my opinion. So I don't think it's going to see a lot of constructed play. It might be good in limited. I definitely played that Drake in limited, so this could be good. Very excited about that, actually. I think it'll be fun. I love, as you know, I love playing counter spells in limited, so especially in this format. So we'll see. We'll see. Then we get the Guild Mages. We got Zamek Guild Mage, the Simic one. So green blue for 2/2. And first ability, green blue. This turn, each creature you control enters the battlefield with an additional +1/+1 counter on it. And then green blue, remove a +1/+1 counter from a creature you control, draw a card. Pretty cool. Dust Mantle Guild Mage. So black, so blue black. And then for 1 blue black, whenever a card is put into an opponent's graveyard from anywhere, this turn that player loses 1 life, or 2 blue black, target player puts top 2 cards of his or her library into his or her graveyard. That's cool. So, again, focusing on the mill strategy. Pretty sweet pictures for both of them. And then next we get Obsidat, Ghost Council. This is the new Ghost Daddy. So it's 1 more mana. It's a 1 white, white, black, black. For a 5/5 now instead of a 4/4. Just reminding you, this is the old Ghost Council of Verzova. So again, a legendary creature. It's a spirit advisor this time. And when it enters the battlefield, target opponent loses 2 life and you gain 1 life. And you gain 2 life. So it's different than the Ghost Counselor, the old Ghost Daddy 1.0, where you only drained for 1. And at the beginning of your end step, you may exile it. If you do, return to the battlefield under its opponent's control. At the beginning of your next upkeep, it gains haste. So it's awesome because this is repeatable. You don't have to sack a creature like Ghost Daddy to get it to flicker in and out. So there's good and bad. Obviously, you can't save it from removal by flickering it, but you also don't have to sack a guy. So every turn, you're absolutely, if you don't need the blocker, you're going to be draining for 2 life, right? So already that's huge. 2 life is way better than 1. It's also 5/5. It also gets haste every time you flicker it back in. And because it's not going to be there on the opponent's turn, it dodges all sorcery speed removal, Wrath of Gods, Dreadbores, things like that. It cannot touch it. So that's really awesome. I'm very excited about this card. I love Orzhov Guild, and I love this card. And then we've got the Demir dude, Lazav Demir Mastermind. So 4/3/3, hexproof. And when a creature is put into an opponent's graveyard, you may have Lazav Demir Mastermind become a copy of that card, except it's still called Lazav, it's legendary, and it has hexproof. So again, plays with the mill strategy. So, you know, you get like a glimpse of the unthinkable or something like that, and you can change him into, I don't know, like a 5/5 or something. So it seems pretty neat. And then we've got, lastly, we've got Gideon, Champion of Justice. So I thought that this would be a red-white planeswalker. It's not. It's two white-white, four loyalty. So you plus one, put a loyalty counter on Gideon for each creature target opponent controls. That's interesting. Until end of turn, Gideon, Champion of Justice, becomes an indestructible human creature with power toughness equal number of loyalty counters on him. And prevent all damage that would be dealt to him. Okay. Okay. So same sort of deal as the old Gideon. If you remember, the old Gideon was, boom, five mana, similar thing, right? But now this dude has an ultimate. Minus 15, exile all other permanents. If you can ultimate Gideon, you just win the game easily, right? Every turn you beat down with a indestructible dude, right? Awesome. Only problem is, he can't protect himself, which I guess the old Gideon couldn't do either. I don't know. It just seems lazy. I'm just not a big fan of it. Like, the plus one ability just gives more loyalty counters, and then its zero ability is the same ultimate, and I don't know. Just not a big fan. Art's okay. Again, sort of a different style. Doesn't seem magic-y, in my opinion. No, whatever. Still, it's a planeswalker, right? I mean, you're going to play planeswalkers in limited no matter what. Probably. All right, so thanks for watching. In terms of my favorite... Thanks for watching. You can check out my channel for more stuff. So, first of all, my favorite card that's been released, that's been spoiled this week, was the Ghost Council, the new Obdabedat, or whatever it's called. The new Ghost Daddy 2.0. But it's also tied with this awful, awful Sky Knight Legionnaire artwork. Also one of my favorite cards that's been spoiled this week. So, anyways, check out my channel. I've got more Gatecrash spoilers. Subscribe to my channel if you like it. Like this video if you like it. And also, there are going to be some drafts that are put up, one of which is the community draft. So, if you don't know, what happened was Derek Boyko and Josh Frankel from Draft Magic, and also Semulin or Travis from Mana Deprived, and Zedman23, who also does some streaming and casting. We all got together, jumped into a Swiss draft together, and drafted Return of Ravnica. So sooner or later, I mean, I think two drafts are up right now. Two perspectives are up right now. But sooner or later, everyone's going to look inside. Everyone's going to have their draft videos uploaded. And you can see the point of view from five different cameras on an eight-man draft. So you see who passed to who, what they did. You get to play, see the match from two different vantage points. Really fun, really cool. So check it out. Thanks for watching, and as always, see you on the other side.